today's lecture will be about logic. Logic is the foundation for mathematics. This is for the Platonic universe, the counterpart of a long dream for physicists, which is the existence of a unified theory, something that would describe everything that can be described in the physical universe. Physicists had a lot of hopes that such a program could be achieved after it worked for electromagnetism and the standard model of particles, and it seemed like all the forces in nature could be described as part of one single theory. Nowadays, this program is a bit more suspicious because we encounter fundamental difficulties to unify, in particular, general relativity with quantum mechanics. But in mathematics, on the other hand, in the Platonic universe, it seems even more clear that such a program could be achieved. It was one of the, I believe it was the 10th problem of Hilbert, so it was one of the big challenges put by Hilbert, one of the greatest mathematicians of the 20th century, asked to his peers, or the future generations of mathematicians, to derive all of mathematics from a set of fundamental rules, or as we call them in math, of axioms, by using the rules of logic. And this is these rules, these principles, and actually, to be practical, these notations of logic that we are going to introduce. Indeed, the Platonic universe, we can see it as made out of objects, mathematical objects, and we have started to describe them last time, as well as statements about these objects. So these statements, we'll call them under various names, like propositions, or well, statements, or claims. I will use actually things like relations as well, a relation. And whenever something is true, when a statement can be asserted to be true, then we call that a theorem. And whatever can be shown to be true as derived by the rules of logic applied to the axiom, in principle, should reconstruct the entire landscape of what is true and what is not true in the Platonic universe. So R stands for a relation. But I will use probably more commonly the term of proposition because it sounds more like what it is. So a relation can be true or false. And then we have some logical operations that can be made on a relation. So for instance, if you've got a relation R, we can take the negation. This symbol here, negation, turns a true relation into a false one and vice versa. So let me give you an example for a proposition or relation. It could be one that we already used before, like P squared is even. So for a number P. So that's an example of a relation. So this relation is true for some numbers, but not for all of them. For instance, it's true for the number P, which is equal to 2 or 4. Or 6, you can check that the square of fullest number, respectively, they should be 4, 9, and 36, they are all even. So actually, R is the result of the over relation, P is even. That's the one that demonstrated the overtime, so we'll call this one Q. We demonstrated that if Q is true, then R is true. We will not write true, because we'll understand that this is implicit, because that's what logic is about, the fact that something is true. So we'll say that if Q, then R. In more accurate English, or if we are fearing confusion, then we will state the full thing, which is if Q is true, then R is true. And whenever we have relations like this, R and Q, we can relate them together. We can assemble new types of relations thanks to two important logical constructs for which we have these symbols. And we call them the conjunction, I will write the name here, conjunction, or more familiarly, and, or the disjunction, disjunction. And this we will call or. So two logical symbols, operations that are familiar, or and they work like this. If we've got two relations R and Q, so R can be or true or false, and Q can be as well or true or false, so that makes four combinations. We've got for the conjunction, which is R and Q, that this is true only if both R and Q are true, that's why we've got the R, and this is always false otherwise. And for the R or Q, the disjunction, then this is true if at least one of them is true. So it's true most of the time in this case, except there, where both of them are false. That's how these two things are defined. Of course, we can also define the truth table, that's the name for this thing, for the negation, is the one that makes the true statement false and the false statement true. Very good. So, what do we do with this logical construct? Well, one first very important, and actually not that intuitive so far, I expect this is very intuitive, but one first logical construct, which is both a bit counterintuitive, as we will discuss, but more than that, very important, is the following logical construct. This is R or not Q. R or not Q. This one, it is so important that we actually give it a dedicated notation. We write it like this. We write Q arrows R. And then that's something we already met before. That's the if Q, then R. We call this an implication. And this is one of the mechanisms to build theorem out of the axiom, because it shows that we can make or establish or prove or demonstrate that a proposition R is true if Q is true. So to satisfy ourselves that this is the case, let's look at the truth table of this thing. So we are going to take the truth table for this two proposition. So it can be true, false, false, true, and false, false. That's all the possibilities. We'll go in turn. We'll look first at not Q. So that's negating Q. That makes it false, false, true, true. And then we look at the conjunction of these two, R and not Q. So it's true when it's true, R or not Q is true when one of them is true. So it's true there, it's false there, it's true there, and it's true there, because we have at least one of them which is always true, which shows that the implication itself is indeed true, except when Q, the premise, Q here, is true and R is false, right? Which means that if Q is false, regardless whether R is true or false, then the implication itself is true. That's why I was saying it's a bit counterintuitive or maybe subtle. If I write this, let's take a particular example to make sure that you understand. If I write this, 4 is prime, implies that 2 plus 2 equals 5. What do you think of this implication? It is true, the implication is true. Why? Because this is not true, of course, but because the premise, the one that we have on the left of the arrow, is false itself, it doesn't invalidate the implication. The implication is correct because the if statement is false. So if something is false, that can imply something which is also false, right? So this is true. This in the box is true, even though both the premise and the conclusion, the implications are false. Of course, we are more interested to have something which is true there, because then that makes this one true, and we are interested in true relations. So to make this true, we need to show that this one is true. If we look again, so I use Q and R. If we look at it in this way, if Q, then R. That shows two things. That shows that Q is a so-called sufficient condition for R, which means that Q doesn't have to be true, but if it is true, then R is true. And from the point of view of R, it shows that R is a necessary condition for Q, which means that Q cannot be true unless R is true. If we look at the other way around, or the opposite of this implication, that we call the converse, which is R implies Q. It can or cannot be true, right? If it's true in the both sense, if Q implies R and R implies Q is correct, which means that we've got the following relation and the converse is true. This is equivalent to this notation. So we use another notation. We put the arrows in the two sense, Q and R. And this we call an equivalent, or the other notation, if and only if. If is for necessary, only if is for the, sorry, if is for the sufficient, only if is for necessary condition. Okay, so Q and R becomes sufficient and necessary condition for each other. So that's an important concept, and we are going to play with some of them. For instance, let's look at one theorem that we demonstrated last time, which shows that P squared is even imply P is even. You remember that in the steps of Epasus, when we were demonstrating that square root of 2 is not rational, we needed this property that if the square of an integer is even, then the integer itself is even. Is it true the other way around? If it is true, so we will have to find it out. Let's have a look. So if P is even, it means that there exists a number Q, so that P is twice this number. That's the definition of being even. Let's look at the square. The square is 4q squared. This is 2 times 2q squared. This is a number, whatever it is, but this number multiplied by 2 is p squared. So if p is even, p squared is also trivially even. That's even simpler. So we can say that the converse is true and it becomes an equivalence. The two statements go in the both sense. Let's look at other ways to construct, to manipulate logical expressions. So, for instance, let's assume that we have now three relations, P, Q, and R. Three statements, three propositions. If we look at the conjunctions, and this one is a disjunction, Q and R, we can distribute them in this way. That's P and Q, or P and R. That's the distributive way to look at this equality. I'll let you convince for yourself or demonstrate that this is the case. The other way around, if we've got now the disjunction here and the conjunction of the statements in the parentheses, we can also distribute it in this way. Not that the parentheses are important there. P or R. Fine. Let's carry on. This one is actually very simple. If you remember that P implies Q is equivalent as non-Q or P. We can write this non-Q or P as non-Q or non-P. So I'm negating twice. If I negate twice, I come back to the original statement, which, by the way, is playing when you are looking at something like this. Nothing is trivial in logic. Is playing with the definition. If you are looking at the conjunction of a statement and its negation, this is always true. So this, it has a particular name. We call that a tautology, this type of statement. So I can write it like this. There are no orders for the statements. And this, if I translate it back in the definition of the implication, you can see that this is non-Q implies non-P this time, right? So we have demonstrated, if I remove the intermediate steps, we have demonstrated that P implies Q is equivalent to non-Q implies non-P. And this is really important because actually that's what we use to demonstrate this property. P squared even implies P is even. It might not be easy to demonstrate it in this way. If we wanted to demonstrate it starting from the premise that P squared is even, we'll have to say that P squared is the multiple of 2 of some number k. And then we'll have to try to find from this property how to make a meaningful statement regarding P itself. It's actually easier to demonstrate the other way around, which is, so that should be equivalent. If this is correct, this is equivalent to P not even. Let's go slowly. So not P even implies not P squared even. But what does it mean, the negation of being even? If the number is not even, it is odd. So the statement is, again, I write the equivalent, is P odd implies, that's 2D, implies P squared is odd. It's the same thing. To negate that P squared is even, it means that P squared should be odd. And this is actually easier to demonstrate because that's the proof we did last time, that P can be written on this type. We take the square, that's 4k squared plus the double product plus 1, and this is twice a number, which is 2k squared plus k plus 1, which means that P squared is odd. So we indeed demonstrated it. So then, by the game of the equivalence, we come back to our initial statement, which is this one. So you see, this is a very important property. I can put it in the red box. Try to remember this. If you've got one proposition implies another, it's equivalent to say that the implied proposition negated imply the negated implying proposition. If you got an equivalence, of course, P is equivalent to Q, then it's the same to say that non-P is equivalent to non-Q. Or not P is equivalent to not Q, because there is no sense of the arrow, because one implication is equally valid as the other. So an important tool to demonstrate a property and to derive theorem. Now, let's look at another important concept of logic, which is the concept of quantifiers. There are two quantifiers, just how we have two important ways to relate logical proposition, which is or and. We have two quantifiers, which are the opposite of A for all. So the opposite, I mean, is the reverse A, and the reverse of E. The reverse of E for exists, which we write like this. So this one we call it for all, and this one we call it there exists. So they are quantifiers in the sense that they make statements of the type. Let me give you an example. There exists X in the set Q minus, sorry, that's R minus Q, the set of irrational, such that X squared is equal to 2. This is also what we demonstrated last time, following Epasus. It shows that square root of 2 is irrational. You would notice that, so this statement is true, that's the theorem. This one is not true. There exists X in the set of rational such that X squared equal to. This statement here is false. That's precisely what Epasus demonstrated. They couldn't find such a number in Q with this property. But that illustrates the example for a quantifier of existence. Let's have a look now at the other quantifier for all. So it could be something like this, for instance, for all X that belongs to the set R, for all real numbers, then X squared is positive, yeah, which is also something that we used at some point, or that we will use later on. In the set of real numbers, if we take any number which is negative or positive, its square is always positive, because the minus 1 cancels. Now, let's look at logical constructs which come with several quantifiers, and in which case the order matters, if we have the for all and there exist that comes together in one proposition, in one statement. Let's take an example, for instance, to describe this concept of asymptote. You know this concept of asymptote. It's when a curve gets close to a value. I'll put the asymptote there, so that's A, let us say, and the function that can cross the asymptote somewhere else, yeah, they get very close, but they never touch it. So one example, for instance, is 1 over x. 1 over x gets as close to 0 as we want it to be, but it never actually touches the thing. So to describe or to write this in logical terms, in terms of the quantifier, we could say that for all epsilon larger than 0, not being equal to 0, strictly larger than 0, there exists a real number x such that the function f of x minus a is larger than epsilon. So is smaller than epsilon. Okay, so we have to be careful here because it actually gets equal to the thing. So we would have to start from there, from this onward. It says that however close we want to bring our function to the asymptote, indeed we can find x such that the function will approach this asymptote. So you see that the order matters here, because if we look at the over order where the existence arrives before, which reads like this, of course. So there exists an x such that for all epsilon, then f of x minus a is smaller than epsilon. What does it tell us, this statement? So let's look at this one. However small we take epsilon, because we take all the possible values, so we can take the small values that are the one of interest here, because we are comparing for the values that are below. So if it's smaller than the big number, of course it's smaller than all the other numbers. So let's look at epsilon, which is very small. So however small we take this epsilon, f of x minus a, which is the distance, that is the absolute value here, which is the distance of f between f of x and a, is less than this number. Which means that this is equal to, they are equal, which means that f of x is equal to a. There is an x, yeah, for which the function become equal to the asymptote, or the asymptote, to this value a that appears in this proposition. So it's very different because here we are describing an asymptote. Here we are making a trivial statement. We are saying that a is a value that the function can take. So the order matters, tend to matter. It doesn't matter if we have several for all quantifiers, so for all x, for all y, proposition R that depends on x and y is equivalent as for all y, for all x, proposition R. Here the order doesn't matter. It doesn't matter neither if we have only for existential quantifiers. This is equivalent to the reversed order. And we don't have any equivalence because we just demonstrated that the order matters, but we've got the implication if we have this order. There exists for all y, r, x, y. This implies, so I'd like to write it like this, thinking that you see what I mean. Yeah, I mean that this implies this. Because we are doing logic, maybe we should, at least for this lecture, be a bit careful and rigorous with notation. So I will use the normal notation, which is the horizontal arrow. So here we can reverse the order. For all y, there exists x. And you can convince indeed that this is the case, because if there is an x for which all the y satisfy the proposition, then for all the y, there exists an x, namely the x that applies to all of them. And this is an obvious statement, if you think about it. So in this case, we can reverse the order, because in fact, what we are doing is weakening the statement. The other way around, this way, is not correct. This is not true, as we have just shown by an example. Now, let us look at the negation of the quantifiers, or the logical construct. So far, we have only negated one proposition. Now, let us negate, for instance, the conjunctions, R and S, for instance. So if we negate that, the way it works is given by the De Morgan's rule. It states that we distribute the negation and we change the and for or and vice versa. So that becomes negation of R and negation of S. Similarly, the negation of R and S is the negation of R or the negation of S. These are the Morgan's rule. You can also as well convince yourself one way or the other that this is correct. For instance, you can show it by writing the truth table on the both sides and see that they coincide perfectly. Let us look at the negation of the implication. What does it mean to negate an implication? This is something important because we always have, as I said, the implication is one of the main tools to construct theorem, to derive new truth statement out of axioms. And one way to work with things is to take an implication which we know is false, negate it, therefore we have a truth statement. So if we negate that, this is equivalent to, how would we work? We would first substitute, so we remember that R implies S is the negation of S or R. We apply De Morgan's rule. The negation of negation is the statement itself. The or becomes an and then we negate R. So the negation of R implies S is the conjunction of S and not R, which you cannot write an implication neither. Let's look at an example. P square is even implies P is even. That's one implication with which we are familiar. We are going, so it is true, as we know now. We are going to negate it. The negation of this tells us, so this one, p square is even being the r. So and the other one, I'll take another color. This one being s. So I want to write s. S is P is even and not R. Not R is not P square is even. We negate that P square is even, which means that P square is odd. P square is odd. And because this was true, then this or this must be false. So this statement, now we have something which is false, that p is even and p squared is odd. And think about it, this is indeed equivalent to the implication we demonstrated before. If a number is even, then its square cannot be odd at the same time. Cannot be odd at the same time. The simultaneous, the at the same time, is this and. So that's clearly a false statement. After negating the implication, we can now negate the quantifiers themselves. Okay. And the negation of the quantifier is also something simple and symmetric and beautiful. The negation of the for all quantifier is the existence. And similarly, the negation of the existence is the universal quantifier for all. So like this, if you got for all x belongs to for all x we have a relation R, then we can say that this is the negation of, let's negate what is inside, the negation of for all is exist x, not r. That's the negation. So in this way, you see that, in fact, we only need one quantifier because we could express everything in terms of the one we choose. If we want to choose exist, we every time we need the for all, we can express it in that in terms of the negation. But of course, it's convenient to introduce the concept that we need to make things intuitive, simple, and concise. So let's take the other example. We are going to negate this one. This is the negation of exist is for all, not R. And you can indeed as well convince yourself that on logical grounds, this makes sense. If it is true that for all x, we have a statement, a relation R that is true, then it is not true that there exists one x for which this relation is not true, which is what is written there. And similarly, if there exists one x, one case for which a relation is true, then it is not true that for all x this relation is not true. I mean, take the time to think about it, but this logical statement properties that we are writing down there as a mechanical application of the rules, they make perfect sense, they're even intuitive. If we would like to take one example, there is one which is very famous even from the times of the Greek people, which is that all men are mortal, therefore Pythagoras, I think it was Pythagoras or Archimedes, is mortal. So the negation of all men are mortal is there exists an immortal man. It is not, in particular, all men are immortal. So we need to be careful in applying rigorously the negation of logical statements.
A. Socrates is a man. B. All men are mortal. C. All men are Socrates.
Let's look at how we would negate a logical construct that involves several quantifiers. So let's take that we've got a relation xy which is stated for all x and under the existence of one y. The negation of this, let's put some color. So how we negate in general terms, the negation is obtained by negating in the same order every part of the logical construct. So we would have there exists x such that for all y, not r. That's the negation of this logical construct. Again, you are invited to apply it to cases that we have already looked at as exercise, and you will see that it works well and it corresponds to what it should. It's one way or the other to look at a truth statement. Now, we have seen mainly what constitute the most important aspects of logic. We are going to look at something which is quite related, and that brings us back to this important notion of sets and how these things are related to sets. So we have this concept of sets A and B. Important relationship between sets is that one set can be part of another set. We call that a subset. So remember that an object, an element, can belong to a set, but a subset is included in the other set, right? So that's what these two symbols mean. So the fact that A is a subset of B, this is equivalent to saying that if A belongs to A, then A belongs to B. I hope that you can convince yourself that this is the case. I'll give you now various notions that we will need time to time, or maybe not frequently, but that we might encounter and that are important. One is the complementarity offset. So if we have this, for instance, x minus a, with a being part, it doesn't have to be part, it could be a bit outside, but we've got one set x and the set a. The set x minus a, there are various notations. One is like this, or some like to write it like this. Well, various notations, doesn't matter, we'll use this one for now. To say that an element is in x minus a, the complementary of a in x, it is to say that a belongs to x, and a does not belong to a, big A. The element does not belong to the set. That's the definition of the complementarity. Out of which you can demonstrate various properties. So for instance, let me give you this as an example. If A is a subset of B, then this implies that the complementary on another set that we call C is included in the complementary of A. Well, let me use x again so that we don't confuse this c with this operator, which is subset is included. So I will put the x here. So I let you demonstrate this one, for instance. I will demonstrate with you this other one, which is more interesting because it looks simpler. The complementary in A of the complementary in A of B is P. And this looks trivial written like this, because if we look at the rules of algebra, we've got a minus a, and then minus minus b becomes plus, so the a cancel, and we are left with b. But here we are using notations. We are not doing algebra of additions with numbers. What we are doing is using notation for the set. And this notation has been used because it has some consistency. It behaves a bit like this notion of subtraction, and indeed you see that this works. So that makes it like a nice mnemonic, maybe. But we cannot prove it in the way that we would do using algebraic method. What we need to do is to re-demonstrate it. So we have to show that if we take a number A in this set, what does it mean? So here we have to use the notion, the definition of before, which is it's here. We use this definition. It means that A belongs to A, and A does not belong to A minus B. I will use this one. I will not write everything again, but I will still use, so I will imply that it's written again. I put the equivalence sign because I'm going from one line to the other by doing equivalences, even though I don't write everything again. So this means by definition that A is not, is the negation of A being in A and B. I write everything again. And now I expand this, so I apply the same definition. It means that A is in A, and A is not in B. That's what it means to be in A minus B. So here I need to put this because the negation applies to the entire statement. I will actually now expand. So remember that I'm going from one line to the other by equivalence. I'm going to expand this negation over the entire logical construct using Morgan's law. That tells us, remember, that we have to negate we have to negate this, we change the and for or, and we have to negate the over. And this was like this. Again, equivalence. So A is not in A, or A is in B. That's what it means, yeah? To negate that A is not in B, it means that A is in B. So now let's write everything again. I can write it there. So if I didn't removed it, it would have been there from the start. It was this, okay? And here we have this square bracket. So now we use the distribution of one statement over the other that we have seen before. That tells us that A belongs to A. Let me find it again, just in case you don't believe me. The distribution of this statement was at the beginning. It is here. So now we are using, it's the and the first, we are using one of these two. I think we are using this one. So we come back at the end. We are using this one indeed. So that's A doesn't belong to A, or A belongs to A, and A belongs to B. That's the statement. So what do we have here? Here we have what we call a contradiction. Contradiction, so we introduce the tautology, we didn't introduce the contradiction. Contradiction is a proposition and its opposite. So this is always false. Like the tautology was always true, the contradiction is always false. We hope that in mathematics there are no contradictions that are true. If we have such a statement that should be true, if we can prove that such a statement is true, it would mean that all the mathematical edifice would collapse. Because if one proposition is both true and wrong, then everything is false. So this means that this thing is false. But we are looking at this in conjunction or with something else. So what we can do is just ignore this contradiction. It just disappears from the logical construct, and we are left with the other one, which is that A belongs to A and A belongs to B. And to belong to both A and B, it means that A belongs to the intersection of A and B. So let's have a look at what we had initially. What I wanted to prove was that this is A intersection B. Actually, when I write this thing, I am making one assumption. I am making one assumption, is that B is a subset of A. I'm taking the complementary of B in a subset that fully encloses it. Otherwise, this wouldn't be true. We chose, by the way, that we shouldn't take the notation so light-heartedly, because the actual correct thing is this, not the one I wrote before. If A is included in B, if we add this premise here, this important condition, then B is included in A. A belonging to B means that it belongs to A. So this one becomes redundant again, and then we are left with A belongs to A. And then that proves indeed that this is equal to B. I said A is included in B is included in A. B is included in A. Okay, B is included in A, which is written there. So in this statement, what we need to keep is this one. Yeah, because if B is in A, if you are in B, you are in A. But if you are in A, you don't have to be in B. Let's draw it. That's B, that's A. So B here is included in A indeed. So if I've got an element which is in both A and B, it's enough to say that it's in B. I'm not using information by restricting to B. And then that brings us to the result, which is here, B. Fine. When I wrote before that it was in A, like this, it's not true, because if I've got this element, it's in A, but it's not in B. So I was not restricting correctly. And then we see again, so let's write the what I wrote before, A minus B. I wrote that this is B, but this is when B is included in A. If not, let's look at this example, for instance. We've got A here and we've got B here. What is A minus B? What is the complementary of B in A? This is this set. This is the set of left elements that are in A, but are not in B. So maybe my coloring is not making it clear. I will shade it like this. Let's take a nice shade of blue, this one. That's like this, yeah? That's all these elements, which means that I am excluding this. This is not there. And now, so this is A minus B, the complementary of B in A. Now, let's look at the complementary of this set in A, which means the element that are in A, but not in this shaded blue thing. What is it? Clearly, it is in yellow. It is precisely this thing. This is A minus B. And you can see that this is not equal to B, because B is this greenish, is this set. If I can put the color, B is this set. Right? So clearly, this is A intersection B. A intersection B is this set in yellow. So let's be careful with the notations. We can make mistakes, and it's good if we can demonstrate things. You see that demonstrating this equality brought us to realize together that it was assuming a condition that had slipped out of my mind and make me believe something which is not true. Okay, more things about sets that are important. the counterpart of the distributivity forset. This I will let you as well consider for yourself, because this is fairly simple. When you've got the intersection of a set with an union, so I let you check that if it was all intersection or all union, the parentheses wouldn't matter, which means that the intersection and union, they are associative. But when they are mixed like this, so it brings us to like the relation of addition and multiplication, we've got this that I let you demonstrate. It's also easy to demonstrate. The intersection, union, the intersection, like this. So it's distribution of the intersection and union. And vice versa, if we have the union and the intersection, we've got AUB intersected with AUC. All these things we might need at some point or the other when we do geometry or even for algebra analysis. So it's important that you either understand them or know where to find them. And we'll conclude maybe with De Morgan's relation for the set. I believe actually De Morgan didn't come for the logical construct themselves, but he wrote this relation for the set, in which case it's the negation. So the negation is the complementarity. It reads something like this. So the complementarity of A in the set X intersected with the complementary of set B in X, it's equal to the complementary of the union. So here we have an intersection that becomes a union. And vice versa, we've got the intersection, this time, sorry, the union, becomes the complementary of the intersection. I try to use the same color. So that's the Morgan's law for the set. So here, I gave you more or less a big, broad overview of logical operations, concepts, notations that will be important. Logic by itself is an entire field, and actually we are going to finish this lecture by making a surprising and very interesting, very subtle statement, which of course we cannot exhaust in the little time that we have left. I believe probably couldn't exhaust it if we would dedicate the entire remaining of this lecture to this question. It's related to this idea I was commenting at the beginning, that we might have a unified theory of everything, something out of which everything else flows, everything else follows, is obtained out of these things. So that's the theory of everything, the famous two, like the two of your feet, the theory of everything for physics, and that's this Hilbert program for logic, that everything can follow from the axiom. You have your set of axiom, has to be identified, maybe, that's precisely what Hilbert was asking, what are the axioms out of which we can construct of all mathematics. So someone, this person here, Gödel, demonstrated proof that surprisingly, even in mathematics, even for the Platonic universe, we cannot derive everything from the axiom, provided that we've got an axiomatic system that is rich enough. He was taking the one that out of which you can derive arithmetic. Arithmetic, in any set of axioms that out of which you can derive the rules of arithmetic, demonstrate the Euclid's theorem, this fundamental theorem of arithmetic, that all number can be decomposed as product of prime in a unique fashion, so on and so forth. Any such sets of axiom will include in the Platonic universe that comes out of it some statement of which you cannot decide if they are true or false. These are called undecidable statements. We will see some examples actually of such statements of which we cannot decide if they are true or false. And then it's for you to decide if they are true or false by adding, enriching your set of axioms and saying, okay, so this statement, we'll see the particular case of the hypothesis of the continuum. So we decide that it's true. So now we are working under the assumption that this statement is true. But then there will always be some other statements that are like this, undecidable. So both in physics, so it seems, actually in physics we don't know yet. We don't know if everything can follow from a theory of everything. But in mathematics, that sounded, that seems much more robust, much more secure in this respect, there it has been demonstrated that there is no such set of axioms that is both consistent, doesn't generate some contradiction, some self-inconsistent statement. It cannot be both consistent and complete. That's the incompleteness theorem of Gödel. And this is really surprising, because it shows that even in the Platonic universe, which is the most solid, most accurate, most rigorous universe we can dream of, we can imagine, even there is room for incompleteness, unknown, I don't want to say uncertainty, but that there are things that will never be, we'll never know for sure based only on our knowledge of the axioms.